Students, how is everyone? I hope that everyone is fine and staying safe at home and learning. So today what we are going to do is, we are going to continue with our lesson, that is elements, compounds and mixture. That is the second part of the lesson. Now today we are going to learn how to separate different mixtures. Just to recollect, in the last class we did about elements, their characteristics, compounds and mixtures. Today I'm going to teach you about how can different mixtures be separated from each other. Now to separate the mixture, whether it is homogeneous or heterogeneous, if you remember, a mixture which has uniform composition throughout is called homogeneous mixture, like milk, air. Heterogeneous mixture are those which have separate components or their constituents are not the same throughout, like oil and water. You can see when you mix oil and water, you can see oil at the top and water at the bottom. So here today we are going to learn the techniques where the components of the mixture can be separated. Let the mixture be homogeneous or let it be heterogeneous. To separate the mixtures, either homogeneous or heterogeneous, you have to understand certain physical properties of the constituents. Now, what are the physical quantities which you are going to consider? Density, melting point and boiling point, magnetic property, solubility in common use solvent such as water or ethanol, and nature to sublime. Now, please remember, sublime means directly a solid getting converted into the gaseous state without going to the liquid state. Now, don't be confused, students, because each property I'm going to discuss with the method of separation. While discussing the method of separation, I'll give you a brief description about this. Now, suppose, what are the commonly used methods of separation? The first one which we are going to learn today is sedimentation and decantation. Now, what is sedimentation? When you allow a mixture, let it be homogeneous or heterogeneous, the substance having higher density will settle down and the substance having lower density will start to float. Now, suppose I want to separate water from mud. I have got muddy water. That's a homogeneous mixture. If you allow the muddy water to stand for 2 or 3 hours, after 2 and 3 hours, you will observe that the mud starts settling at the bottom. And you can see crystal clear water at the top. So what you have done is, you have done the process of sedimentation. You have allowed the heavier particle or the particle having heavy density to settle down. Slowly you tilt the test tube and remove the water from the test tube. The process which you are doing here is decantation. So sedimentation and decantation are used to separate heavy insoluble solid components from liquid component present in the mixture. And the physical quantity involved here in the method of separation is density. Your heavy particles are more dense, therefore they settle down, and your liquid component has less density, so it will start floating and you can remove the liquid component. A mixture of sand, rice and dal can be separated by the same method. Next method is filtration. You can continue with the example of muddy water. When I pass the muddy water through a filter paper, the mud having a larger particle size will be trapped in the filter paper and water will pass through the filter paper. You can do this activity at home. What you can do is, you can take a circular filter paper, even you can use a tissue paper, 2 or 3 tissue papers combined will act as a filter paper. Place that filter paper in a funnel. Here in the book, they have showed you the method how to prepare. What you can do is, this is your tissue paper. Fold it once like this. It will become this. Fold it again like this. That means take a 4-fold. The tissue paper will become like this. Open one of the folds. You will have a cone in front of you. All right. So what happens is, you can clearly see that when you pass the muddy water through filter paper, the mud or the sand will be left in the filter paper. And the mud or the sand which is left over in the filter paper is known as residue. And you can see the clear water in the beaker. Now, filtration is used to separate insoluble solid component from liquid component. For example, sand and water, mud in water. Now, this is a heterogeneous mixture because mud does not completely dissolve in water or sand does not completely dissolve in water. Therefore, it is an example of heterogeneous mixture. Evaporation. Now, this method is used to separate soluble non-volatile component from a liquid component. For example, sugar from sugar solution. Now, when you dissolve sugar in water, it completely gets dissolved and the mixture formed is a homogeneous mixture. If I want to separate sugar from water or salt from water, I will take the solution. If I want to separate sugar, I will take the sugar solution and start evaporating it. After some time, you will see that a water starts evaporating and the leftover component is sugar. You can apply the same method for salt dissolved in water. So evaporation is used for those solid components which are soluble in liquid component. Now here there is an activity given in your book. The activity is to separate a mixture of sodium chloride, that is NaCl, and calcium carbonate. We all know that sodium chloride is soluble in water, whereas calcium carbonate is insoluble in water. So here we are going to apply two methods. One will be filtration and second will be evaporation. Why filtration? Because when we filter, we are going to mix sodium chloride and calcium carbonate in water. Now sodium chloride is soluble in water, therefore it will dissolve in water. Whereas calcium carbonate being insoluble in water will remain suspended in the solution. Once you pass this mixture through a filter paper, in the filter paper, calcium carbonate will be left as a residue. Please recall the previous example which we have done. Now the solution in the beaker will be your salt solution. Take that solution, put that solution in a china dish and start evaporating. Water will evaporate out and the crystals left will be of salt. Now students, I want you to remember one more process which is not given in your book. It is called as crystallization. Because when you operate this or when you heat the sugar solution or salt solution, sugar or salt crystals are not directly obtained. If you allow the thick mass left behind after evaporation to cool, the crystals start forming and the process is crystallization. So let's read the procedure. Place the mixture of sodium chloride and calcium carbonate in the beaker filled with water. Allow sodium chloride to dissolve. Then filter the solution through filter paper. The undissolved sediment or the undissolved substance obtained appears milky. The sediment will remain on the filter paper, but the dissolved salt will pass through the filter paper present in water. Then sodium chloride is obtained by evaporating water. Sodium chloride is now separated from insoluble calcium carbonate. Your observation is the residue collected on filter paper is calcium carbonate. Filtrate collected is NaCl solution, which can be evaporated to collect solid sodium chloride. The next method is distillation. Now, distillation is the principle involved in distillation is the difference between the boiling points of two components. And please remember, students, in the first lesson, we have done the term boiling. The temperature at which a liquid starts getting converted into the vapor state is called boiling. Now, I suppose you have two liquid components like alcohol and water. Alcohol boils around approximately 60 degrees Celsius and water boils at 100 degrees Celsius. When you are applying the process of distillation, two things you have to keep in mind. First is the two components should have a minimum difference of boiling point of at least 20 degrees Celsius. Now what you will do is, like suppose if I want to separate alcohol from water. Now alcohol and water are completely miscible. What do I mean miscible? When two liquids component completely dissolve in one another, they are called as miscible liquid. So you will take the miscible liquid in the round bottom flask. Now this is your round bottom flask. Take the mixture of alcohol and water here. Fit it with the rubber cork which is here. Place that fractionating column here which has a thermometer, so that the gas, when you are heating the mixture, whatever gas is formed passes through the fractionating column. This is your fractionating column. This part is called as condenser. What do I mean by condenser? When the vapors will pass through this column, that is condenser, the water present in that column will cool the gas. Now if you can clearly see the pipe which is passing the condenser will not allow the gas and the water in the condenser to mix. The pipe is separately fitted and water passes over the pipe to cool the pipe, so that so the vapors can be cooled and can be converted into the liquid state by the process called as condensation. Now when I start heating the mixture of alcohol and water, as I said, at 60 degrees Celsius alcohol starts vaporizing. I'm not using evaporating, I said vaporizes. That means vapors of alcohol are formed. Now these vapors will pass through the fractionating column and pass through the condenser, where it will start cooling out and the liquid droplets of alcohol will be obtained in the container, that is a reservoir. At 60 degrees Celsius, no water vapor is formed because water has a boiling point of 100 degrees Celsius. So at 60 degrees Celsius, you can see only the vapors of alcohol. Once the temperature starts rising above 60 degrees Celsius, that means all the alcohol have been consumed. Remove the beaker. Let 5 or 6 drops of the liquid coming out be separate.